very long day, I think, at Times Lit Fest, and heard a lot of very exciting authors, I hope, and learnt a lot of new things. Good. So today, my sister Shruti and I, we've written this book on India for Children, where we have tried to talk about, you know, how many of you like, how many of you like history? Yeah, few hands up. How many of you like stories? Everybody likes stories. Have you ever noticed the word history has story in it? Huh? Come, sit again. Sit there. So, do you think it should be his story or her story? Or our story? Okay. So, what we are going to do today, see, mostly when you learn about history, you learn about who fought whom and, you know, which building was built, this, that. We are going to talk about what it was like to live in those times. And we know about these things because of the books and travelers, mostly travelers' accounts. Because the locals don't bother very much to write about this is what you ate and this is how you dressed, because it's just normal. They're going to talk about actions people did. But when travelers come from outside, they remark upon how people, you know, on clothes, food, this, that. So we are going to talk today about two important kingdoms. The first is the kingdom of Vijayanagar, and the second is the court of Akbar. So first about Vijayanagar. Now, I'll just, who, does anybody know who's the most famous king of Vijayanagar? Yeah, Krishnadev Rai, absolutely. So, yeah, and he's become famous because of so many Tenali Ram programs that we have.
राजा वीर प्रतापी श्री कृष्ण राय भूप नवरत्न खचित सिंहासनधिप संगीत नृत्य शिल्प श्री कृष्ण राय भूप श्री कृष्ण राय भूप.
Just a little piece of music from that time, from the court of Krishnadev Rai, to give you a feel of what kind of music, what you could hear his name, Krishna Raya Bhupa. Bhupa is king. So Vijayanagar was a kingdom founded in 1336, and it was there till 1565, and you can see it encompassed almost all of the Deccan, right? Southern Karnataka, southern Andhra, and then right down, and even northern Lanka, actually. Northern Lanka was also under them. And it was the second largest city in the world at that time, the largest in India, with 500,000 inhabitants. And anybody can guess which was the largest city in the world at that time, in the 1500s, early 1500s? Okay. Which is the other most populous country? Which is the other country in the world which has all? Yeah, China, right? What is the capital of China? Beijing. So the first most populous country in the world was Beijing, and we were the second most Vijayanagar was the second most populous country. It was located in a place with a, go back to the previous picture, yeah. So you can see it was surrounded by mountains with a lot of boulders, and there were a lot of monkeys in that space. There is a legend that this was the capital of Sugriv. Anybody knows what the name was? Kishkindha. So this was supposed to be actually the location of Kishkindha. And so the city was, you had a series of walls, and there were gated passes, so anybody approaching had to keep going through these gated passes. This was on the banks of the Tungabhadra, but it was a very dry area. So they had very elaborate water systems. You had canals and, streams were created, brooks were created, which ran through the entire space. So Abdul Razak, who was an Arabic ambassador who had come to the court of, who had come to Vijayanagar, he mentions that he says that one sees numerous running streams and canals formed of chiseled stone, polished and smooth. Now, approach to the city. Next, yeah. This is Vijayanagar. I don't know how clearly you can see it, but this was the valley, that's the Tungabhadra, and the city was spread in that space. Next, yeah. Krishnadev Rai. Now, we know about Krishnadev Rai and the kind of morning routine he used to have. He's been well described by Portuguese travelers and by other travelers. So some of the things which were said about him, he's the most feared and perfect king that could possibly be, cheerful of disposition and very merry. He's of medium height and fair complexion and of good figure. Every morning, he said that the king would drink a half liter of sesame oil, and as well as applying it liberally over his body, he would then exercise with heavy weights and a sword until he has sweated out all the oil, after which he would wrestle with a court wrestler. Apparently still undaunted, he would gallop about on his horse, about the plain in one direction and another till dawn. So all this happened before dawn. I think we get lazy about our morning routines. Think of Krishnadev Raya's morning routine. Only after this would he bathe, pray, and begin his business of the day. So this is actually recreated from a statue of his. Next, yeah. Next. It's going the other way. Yeah, so this is a thing from with wrestlers, because he used to wrestle in the morning. This is from Hampi. Next one, yeah. And he would dress every day. They would wear these hats, which are called kulavis, which were very much in fashion in those days. So the kulavi was stitched hats, 6 to 8 inches long, made of special stiff velvets and satins, which were normally imported. Kulavis would be embroidered and often studded with precious stones. And Abdul Razak says, the king dressed in robes of green satin. Around his neck, he wore a collar composed of pearls of beautiful water and other splendid gems. There was an Italian, Ludovico de Vartima, who said that because the horses also would be dressed in a lot of jewelry, said the king's horse is worth more than some of our cities on account of all the ornaments it wears. He would think the value of the jewels would be more than the net worth of his city on each horse. This is some little bit about men's fashion. Now I'm going to talk about the women and how they dressed. So the kings had a number of wives. Krishnadev Raya had 6, which was a lot, not a lot for a king in those days. One of his wife was Chinna Devi, who was a dancer. It's like a known romance. He saw her dancing and, married her in spite of a lot of opposition. This is a statue at Tirupati. So since that entire area was under them, a lot of the temples in so many other cities were also built under the Vijayanagar time. And that's Chinna Devi, and that is Tirumala Devi, who was his Patrani. Devaraya, so this is a building which would be like the equivalent of the Zanana or the harem. Now, Devaraya, for example, one of the previous kings, had 12,000 wives. And there was a system of sati, so commentators have said that, okay, when this king died, 500 women committed sati with him. So that was quite hard on the women. But otherwise, they were quite educated. And the women's palace in that world was completely manned by women. So you had women accountants, women clerks, women wrestlers. All the posts were duplicated by women in these women's quarters. They would be quite fashionably dressed again. And again, so these are actually from murals in Hampi. It's Vijayanagar, the ruins of Vijayanagar are today called Hampi. So if you get a chance, you should go there. They're reasonably well preserved. It's quite interesting to see them. This is a painting from that period. So they say that everybody, all citizens were very fond of jewelry. And even common street vendors were draped in earrings, necklaces, bracelets and other ornaments. Women would wear saris and men would wear different types of dhotis. During celebrations, both men and women wore circlets in their hair made of flowers, sandalwood, rose water and other perfumes. And if you see the hairstyles, they used to have extremely elaborate hairstyles. I don't think you could do it every day. And these are some of the sketches of the kind of hairstyles the women used to have. People were known for it. You had specialists. The term for a hairstyle specialist is actually an ancient, there's an Indian, ancient Indian term called Serendri. Is anybody finds the term familiar? Anybody came across the word Serendri before? Mahabharata, Draupadi is called Serendri. That's because she had a job as a hairdresser. So that was the thing. Okay. Jewelry was made of, you know, gemstones and gold and silver, but also flowers. So flower jewelry was very popular. And there is a one of the commentators said that roses are sold everywhere. These people could not live without roses, and they look upon them as quite as necessary as food. Okay, now I'm going to talk a bit about arts and the court. So Krishnadev Raya was a great patron of arts. He himself wrote books and all, and he had what they call the Ashtadiggaj. Like you have the Navratan of Akbar, the nine gems and of Vikramaditya, Krishnadev Raya had the Ashtadiggaj. Can anybody name me at least one of them? So these were like the eight wise men or the eight talented men in his court. Absolutely, Tenali Raman, all the kids know about him. And this is a later statue. There was also Purandar Das. I'm not going to talk about all of them, but just a couple. Purandar Das, he's considered the founder, so to say, of the Carnatic system of music. He's called the Pitama. And so he was a jeweler who then became a saint and a musician. He was something called there's a term used in South Indian music called a Vagekar. A Vagekar is a person who writes the words, composes the music and sings it. A bit like your modern pop singers, right? Bappi Lahiri, I don't know, but a bit like the modern, in the West, here we tend, you know, there's somebody else who writes the words, somebody else who composes the music, and somebody else who sings. But there, and he is supposed to, by legend, have written about 5 lakh songs. You know, we Indians invented the zero and we love using it. Today we have about 700 available. So this is, and if you go, you can hear some of his music. It's still there. Everybody sings it. And what I'm trying to say by this is how close we are still to what was created in that court and how much that is still a part of people's daily lives. The other thing I'm not talking about the other Ashtadiggaj or the literature. A lot of the literature was in Sanskrit, but the court language of Vidyanagar was also Telugu and not Kannada. So Telugu actually was the most important language for the kingdom of Vijayanagar, though Hampi today is in Karnataka. Does the costume look familiar with the fan? It looks like your Kuchipudi or Bharatnatyam dress. So essentially the dress that you see today in Kuchipudi or Bharatnatyam is based on Vijayanagar court dress or a Vijayanagar bride's dress. And both of these were performed in the court, and some of the music written for them is still, used today in the performance, like Purandar Das. But also I'd like to say, not only was it performed in Vijayanagar, but it was also performed in the Deccan Sultanates, which were there, like, you know, Golconda, Bijapur and all. And actually, how many of you have heard the term Tillana, which is used in Bharatanatyam for a particular kind of movement, a particular kind of item? It's a instrument, I mean, it's a very heavily based on the tal based thing. The word Tillana has an interesting origin. It comes from Tarana, which is actually a Persian word for song. And Amir Khusro invented the Tarana in North India, where, you know, you don't use words, you're singing, just using words that mean nothing. Same concept, and it started being called Tillana in the South. So there are words in Bharatanatyam vocabulary which actually come from Persian because of the, you know, yeah. Another word which comes from Persian is Peshwa. Peshwa was the word used in the Deccan Sultanate for the chief minister, and then the Marathas were essentially, Shahji used to work for Ahmednagar, so they picked up the term from there for their chief minister. Okay, walking around the city, so Vijayanagar, as I had about 100,000 homes, and it had 500,000 people. If you walked around the bazaars of Vijayanagar, it was, this is a artist creation, you would have a lot of people dressed in jewelry with perfume, this, that, as we already said. You'd also have a lot of foreigners, because they used to have say gunners from Turkmenistan. All the people came to trade. It was the most important and the richest city in India. So all your Portuguese, Italians, all of those people came here to trade, and people from all around, actually, Asia and Europe used to come to trade in Vijayanagar. So you would have a very multicultural kind of crowd. I will talk very briefly about Vijayanagar architecture. This typical Gopuram kind of architecture was there, which is there in the south. Even, say, the Madurai temple was built by a Nayak of Vijayanagar, what you see presently. That style of architecture was there. What really identifies Vijayanagar architecture, they used to have very interesting columns. So these columns would have, you see the horses, right? These columns would have figures. And you, wherever you see, like, Srirangam temple or so many temples across the south, you know it has been built in the Vijayanagar time. And this was a feature of Vijayanagar architecture. Here is another interesting column. I have seen this in Hampi. So each of those stone pillars, if you strike them, gives a different musical note. So these are musical pillars. You can sort of play a tune on these. Now they don't allow it because, you know, there are too many tourists trying to, you know, they're worried about the damage, but it's there. A picture of, say, the flower market, just an idea, and gemstones. So they used to have distinct markets for each product. And for the gemstone market, we've written that you would particularly have gemstones coming in from all over the world. It was one of the biggest markets in the world for gemstones. So you would get rubies from Burma, emeralds from South America, because the Portuguese had already discovered, you know, Brazil. Say Brazil has emeralds. So this is there. Now, I'll just briefly talk about one of their major festivals, which was the Mahanavmi, or the Dashera, right? So the Mysore Dashera is very famous, you've heard of it. So, because Mysore used to be a feudatory for Vijayanagar, all the later kingdoms picked up this concept, but the Vijayanagar Dashera used to be really fantastic. If you go there, there is a whole big plain where you have these kind of tibbas, they are called tibbas. You have these pavilions, and mostly they were 5 stories high. The king's pavilion was 9 stories high. And the king would sit on that in a golden throne. They even had some of these which would revolve. These pavilions were elaborately carved. And you'd have a... This would be the route of the procession. It has been described, the processions, it said ki 1,000 elephants painted and bedecked, a vast open space in front of this where there'd be singers, storytellers, dancers, wrestlers, jugglers. Women would, you know, obviously everybody in their best clothes and dancing. So next image, yeah. This is a Mysore Dashera, but just to give you a picture, of course, Mysore Dashera, they'll have 10, 15 elephants, not 1,000. But just imagine that at that scale. This is carved on the pavilions, you know, you'd have women dancing and walking along like that. Next. And this was a particular feature, I just thought I'd bring it. It still happens in India. People would put these hooks through their flesh at the back and suspend themselves from... this is a modern day photograph, okay? It still goes on. As part of the festival celebration, some very devout people do this to themselves. And a lot of travelers have described this, that wherever you go, there are these people. For 3-4 hours, they would get suspended like this with fish hooks through their back. Kids, don't try it at home. Okay. Now, this city of Vijayanagar, the grand city, was destroyed in 1565, you know, like just a couple of months. The Vijayanagar kings lost to the Deccan Sultans and the city was destroyed. This was in 1565, but we had another great court with even probably even more elaborate features which arose in the north. So Shruti will talk about that.
Let me see if this works. This sound is working? Sorry, so we also want to start off with making you listen to a little bit of the music. So let me see, it's a little complicated. One sec, let me, I think I have to press it. Okay, so that was, of course, a composition by one of Akbar's Navratan, Tansen. And just wanted to give you an idea of what kind of music you might hear as you walked into this city of Fatehpur Sikri, which was built by Akbar. Now, I want to take you through an imaginary day in the life of Akbar. We all hear about him mostly because he's supposed to obviously be a great military commander, but also have a lot of tolerance. So that's really highlighted in our conversations about Akbar. But he actually had a very fascinating personality and a lot of quirks. So we want to go into a few of those quirks today. So just imagine that you are entering through the Buland Darwaza and you kind of enter the fort and suddenly you see a chess game happening. But the chess game is a bit different because they used to play life-size chess over there, where you actually had dancing girls who played the parts of the different pieces. So for example, if a pawn got out, then they would do a little dramatic twirl and pretend to faint and have to be dragged away. The kind of language that the courtiers would have been speaking, of course all of them would have known the early version of Hindustani to speak to the local populace, but the language of the court was Persian. So you would have been hearing Persian going around, and you probably wouldn't be able to understand a word of what is happening if a modern Indian goes back today. Supposing you haven't seen the emperor and you decide to kind of walk on and find out, because Akbar in his own lifetime was as much a celebrity, and people would come just to get a peek of the great man, you know, the same way that people go celebrity sighting today. And suddenly you see somebody walking really, really fast, because everybody always describes that Akbar used to walk at a trot almost, and all the courtiers had to kind of run along to keep up with him. And suddenly you come face to face with Akbar himself. Now this is a little unusual compared to probably the royal portraits you might have seen. This is him as a younger man. And I just want to read out what they say, because a lot of people have actually described what he looked like in detail. So it's a little bit like Goldilocks. They say he was not too dark, not too fair, not too short, not too tall, broad in the shoulder and broad in the chest, and that he was extremely fit and strong. Everybody talks about his eyes, which were typical Mongol eyes, but more than one person says that they have a special type of brilliance. And when they look at you, you kind of feel that he knows everything about you already. So sometimes you hear about very charismatic celebrities today, and how when you meet them, you kind of just fall under their magnetic spell. So people have actually described that in different accounts about Akbar as well. If you see what Akbar is wearing, now before him, all of the rulers, the Muslim rulers of India, would have kept a mustache and a beard. But Akbar decided to actually shave off his beard because he was trying to win over the Rajputs. And he even made up his hair, which you would never see in public without a turban. He left it very long and used to bind it up in the same way that Rajputs used to. Okay? Another peculiarity about him was that he really hated bad smells. And of course, if you live in medieval times without sanitation, it's quite hard to escape bad smells. So apparently you could kind of smell him coming, because he used to put so much perfume. He used to be drenched in it. And there's a kind of funny story which is a little gory for the children, but I'll tell you. So one of his enemies was rebelling, and he sent a commander after him. Eventually they tracked him down somewhere in East India, and then they beheaded him and then got the head home to present to the emperor. But then they said, okay, obviously after traveling in India for a few weeks, it's not going to be particularly helpful. So one of his biographies actually describes how the head was stuffed full of perfumed leaves, just so that when it was presented to the emperor, it wouldn't smell bad. The other thing is, if you see, Akbar used to wear very fine clothes, which we'll talk about a bit when we get into Mughal fashion. Basically, imagine that Akbar has stopped and he's got a very loud and rich voice, they say. And he tells somebody, it is midday, let us proceed with the ceremony. And suddenly you see that there's a priest who starts chanting 1,001 names of the sun in Sanskrit. And Akbar is prostrating himself up and down. So he had actually become quite influenced by Parsi and a few kind of Hindu rituals later on in his life. And every day at midday, he would go out, look, squint into the sun and prostrate himself while 1,001 names of the sun were chanted out in Sanskrit. So then imagine he goes back to his court. And you see that he would So can anybody tell me, maybe the kids, how do Muslim courtiers, like in the Mughal courtiers, how would they pay their respects to the emperor? What is the gesture? So if you might have seen in TV shows, they always do this, right? So that is called the Cornish, actually. And it didn't used to be there forever. Akbar kind of decided he wanted more of a hierarchy than the Mughals and the Mongols typically had. And he's the one who introduced it in the Mughal system. And he made sure that every courtier who went in front of him did it, right? So they come in, but what do we see on the right-hand side? we see the regular courtiers, but we also see these very dark, dressed in dark, severe clothes. These are Jesuit priests, because you already had the Portuguese who had settled into Goa and other regions by then. And they would keep trying to, they were quite fervent in their beliefs, so they really wanted to convert Akbar, because they said if we get all of India, it's going to be a very big spiritual win. So he would keep calling them, and he loved to get into spiritual debate. So he would treat them very nicely, and then he would kind of keep asking them questions. But at the end, after the third visit, they said, okay, at least let us build a church, because clearly you're not going to get converted. So he let them build a church, and basically that was it. I think it was in Agra. Sorry? Yeah, he had, was it Jahangir or Akbar who had two of the brothers became converted to Jahangir's sons? His brothers, yeah, he made his brothers become Christian for a little while just to kind of push them out, but then they converted back. Yeah? Yes, we'll talk about that. He could not read or write, but we think now that he had dyslexia, like probably a very severe form of dyslexia, because it was not general slowness. It was not the fact that Timurid princes were not educated. They were very highly educated in all sorts of things. Humayun would keep writing, like trying to get him to pay attention to his studies, but he was never able to read or write. But he had an exceptional memory. You know, obviously imagine he's surrounded by lakhs of people, but he would actually remember all sorts of names. He would give people pet names. He would give his, you know, pet animals names. He would give his musket. His favorite musket was called Sangram. So he's like, okay, I'll take out Sangram and shoot you. So it was not, we think it probably had to do with dyslexia. But we'll get into that in a bit. So I just want to show you, we don't have, obviously you guys have heard about Shah Jahan's two big feats. One was a Taj Mahal, and the second was actually the Peacock Throne, which not many people know cost twice the amount to build as the Taj Mahal. It was worth like double. And it was taken away by Nadir Shah. And then, so we don't know what a lot of, it was almost 300 years of accumulated beauty and wealth, which are lost to us. But Nadir Shah, when he was going back to Persia, sent one of the smaller thrones to the King of Turkey, and it's still there in the Topkapi Palace. I just want to tell you that this is a throne which, just imagine, this is a kind of like a not so good throne, okay, that the Mughals had. This would be nothing in comparison to the actual Peacock Throne. Now, we all heard of the Navratan. Do any of the kids want to tell me a few of the Navratan? Who are they? We talked about Tansen earlier. Go ahead. Birbal, right? Anybody else knows any of the others? Raja Man Singh. Now, Todarmal, exactly. Now, how many of us know what they actually look like? We don't, right? Normally, they're always artist illustrations. We always see Birbal with the mustache or everything. But I actually went into Mughal miniatures and tried to track down the actual faces that were painted during that time. And so you see Birbal, he looks quite different than what he's, you know. And Tansen, he looks a little forlorn. Abu Fazal, who was like Akbar's right-hand man, and you know. And yeah, he wrote a lot. But Akbar would use him for a lot of things. Whenever he kind of needed him for anything. So once there's a story that Akbar was ill and he called the doctor. And then the doctor came and he said, no, I want to hear what Abul Fazal has to say. So let me see what Abul Fazal has to say about my condition. So they're like, why are you calling me then? Now, Abdul Rahim Khane Khana was a very important person in Akbar's court. Yes. So he was the prime minister, but. So we always talk today about Rahim in the same breath as Kabir, right? We talk about, yes. But they've just renovated it, no, using a project, so you can go and visit it. It's quite nice. But my point is, whenever, at least when we were taught about it, you always thought of Rahim, if you didn't know, if you didn't make the connection, you always thought of them like something like Kabir, you know, living a very simple life or something like that. But if you revisit his dohas, knowing that he was in the thick of politics and military, you kind of start reading them in a different way. From Kabir's very gentle messages, they kind of become Machiavelli's The Prince, you know? And you can really start, it's quite an interesting exercise to start reading it and say, did he actually mean this, or did he mean something much more sinister like Chanakya or Machiavelli? So, just imagine, so you kind of get bored, you say, let me see what else is going on in Fatehpur Sikri in the court. You see that the court was full of people. Akbar used to really like having a lot of people, so there would have been a lot of activity everywhere. So maybe in one corner you would have seen, an archery competition. Then you walk on and suddenly you see a group of people, and these two guys are like squealing and quarreling and screaming, and you wonder what is going on. Suddenly you realize that they are making their pet partridges fight. Okay? This was an honest thing where they would walk around with their champion partridges on their shoulders all day long just to show them off. And they would like bet on them very fiercely. So general animal fighting was very big in Mughal times. So only the king could organize an elephant fight, for example. But even common people would have goat fights, rooster fights and things like that. But I find the idea of all these like really exquisitely dressed noblemen walking around with these big partridges on their shoulders quite funny. Then you get really scared, okay? You suddenly hear this purr growl and you kind of realize what is happening and you think this is the end. Because a cheetah has suddenly come up and decides to rub up against your legs. And you're like, okay, this is not a good situation. So Akbar had a thing. He was presented with a tame cheetah when he was about 13. And he developed a lifelong obsession with them. So he had about 9,000 cheetahs, if you can imagine what that is, over his lifetime. 1,000 at any given time. And his favorite 50 cheetahs were allowed to roam around the court. Some of them had their own personal drummers who would walk in front of them beating a drum announcing their arrival. For example, one of his favorite cheetahs was called Madan Kali. These favorite cheetahs used to be dressed up and blinged out. Okay. In blinged out clothes and jewels. So they would wear gold chains around their necks, you know, zardozi embroidered chashmas, what they were called, like blinkers, and velvet throws across their back. So imagine like the craziest shadi ka ghoda that you've seen, and just up it times 10 and put it on a cheetah. And some of them used to be carried, when they were taken from city to city, they used to be carried about on elephants. So imagine there's a procession and there's an elephant and a cheetah on top of the elephant. Sometimes the cheetah would be carried in a kind of palanquin, and the humans would have to run along beside the cheetah, which is really ironic if you think about the fact that they're the fastest land animal. So, one sec. Okay, so then you come across an elephant, one sole elephant, which is right outside the Diwan-e-Am, which is the common people's court. He's chained there. Looks pretty settled. Can you guys guess what he was there for? Can any of the kids guess why there was always an elephant outside the Akbar's court? Sorry? Not to ride, no. So in India, or at least in Mughal times, it was very simple. If you were sentenced to death, you didn't have a court of appeal, you didn't have months or years in jail. You were taken outside and the elephant had to crush you there and then. So this is a part of a Mughal miniature where the poor guy is kind of done. And brutal justice, so you kind of had to hope you didn't get on the wrong side of anybody important because you couldn't wait around. Now, I want to talk a little bit about Mughal dress because honestly that's what kind of caught the attention of a lot of the Europeans, right? And the Mughals took everything to another level of exquisiteness. Because they had the wealth, the time, the talent, they could nurture it, the patience, and they were enough skillful, you know, they kind of built all these skillful ateliers and factories there were royal factories who used to, just imagine like small scale factories of today, but all these factories would build the most amazing handmade goods, and it was just for royal consumption. There was no buying it, but you could not get better than that anywhere, right? So, can you guys see very well? I guess you might be able to. Can somebody tell me what is the most common character, like what stands out here? It's completely transparent, right? So this is not the artist's imagination, because Indian malbal, Indian muslin, cotton, was known to be so fine that it was called woven air. It was called, which is daft hawa. Some other types were called abe ravan, running water, and others were called shabnam, which means dew. In fact, I read about this, they have some kind of undergarments that they used to wear, which used to be disposable because you could only wear them once. Within wearing them, after 3 hours, they would kind of gallow and kind of tear. So we actually had original disposable fashion, because we can't imagine not reusing cloth stuff. But the Mughal princesses would have only the best. Now, by the way, that is Raja Man Singh, and he had 5,000 wives. So just imagine. I won't say anything else beyond that. When they were not wearing cotton in a very hot climate like India, they would wear very richly embroidered silks that were both woven and embroidered on top with real silver and gold thread. There was none of this imitation stuff for them. So over here on the right-hand side is actually a hunting coat. So just imagine, when we think about hunting, we think about whatever, shikari, shambhu, wearing camouflage or whatever. But these guys used to wear these exquisite works of art even just to go hunting. Now, and the jewelry. We all know about Mughal jewelry, right? Like, there's a big craze for Mughal imitation pieces. So what we did is, these are not imitation, these are actual pieces which still exist. Most of it, again, was taken away by Nadir Shah, but these are actually not from the later period. I've tried to get them as close to Akbar's period as possible. But just to point out just the crazy kind of stuff they used to do, for example, Jahangir, it said that he had a different jewelry set for every day of the year. So he never had to repeat the whole year, because even men would wear jewelry. So if you see, they have this spinel necklace, they have this beautiful pendant with the mother of pearl, and of course these look very familiar to us. The thing over there is something that goes on the turban. So now suppose you keep walking on, and suddenly you come across the Bawarchi Khana, and everybody is in a tiz, because Akbar would eat whenever he wanted to. He was probably the richest and most powerful man alive at that point. And when he died, he left behind, I think, 18 million kilograms of silver, which is worth almost 100,000 crores today. So nobody was telling him when he could or could not eat. And whenever, any time during the day, he would say, okay, I want food. Within 1 hour, the royal cooks had to come up with 100 dishes to serve him. And you know, you couldn't have all of this, oh, today the roti is undercooked and the salt is less. You know, the elephant is there waiting. So you really don't want to get into a bad thing. So being the head chef in Akbar's kitchen was not a joke, basically. So this guy's flapping around. He had to seal every dish with cloth, with his personal seal, because Akbar, as most emperors in that time, were very worried about being poisoned. Then, supposing you see like a younger guy is trying to give some water, and he gets scolded really badly, because the head chef tells him, don't you know that the emperor only drinks water from the Ganga? So all the Mughal emperors actually used to get fresh Ganga water kind of brought to them by fast messenger wherever they were in the country. So in later times, when it had moved to Delhi, they would use Yamuna water for cooking and then add a little bit of Ganga water for purification. So this is something we don't really hear about. And we think it's probably because the reason that Ganga Jal also doesn't get bad. You always hear how you can store Ganga Jal for a long time, it doesn't go bad, is because there are a lot of dissolved metals. But they didn't know that, they just knew that water stays fresh for a very long time. It doesn't get putrid. Now, just want to show you, this is obviously today's thing, but they would cook in big handis, you know, it was not like a small kitchen. And even the stuff that they were served in, for us would be works of art to go behind, you know, museum walls. But they just surrounded themselves with beauty in every possible sphere. So this is actually an emerald cup made of a single emerald, which has been carved. It's a drinking cup. On the left, this is the white jade wine cup. So we always think of wine now in today's European glasses. But they would have these shallow kind of bowls that they would hold like this and drink. And I think that was one of the later emperor's jade cup that was. This is from Babur's time. I couldn't find a feast from Akbar's time. But just imagine this times 100. And basically that there you would have it where they would sit on the carpet and eat. Now, I want to just go into, we always hear about the opulence of the Mughals. And we see it represented in our movies like Jodha Akbar, Mughal-e-Azam. But I tried to track down actual objects that could kind of bring this home as to every single thing that was around them had to be perfect. And Shah Jahan took it to another level with his Taj Mahal, but more or less started with Akbar. So these are just a few, again, I tried to keep it as close to Akbar's time and not to the later time. But just imagine, even their daggers, what they used to kill with, had to be exquisite works of art. Even the key and lock would have an exquisitely carved spinel, because spinel was a very precious stone for them. And that's again a single piece of jade, that's the base of a hookah pipe, that's a flask. So, see some more. So this is a chest with mother of pearl and gold, and all the gold was real. Huh? There's no question that it's like gold plated or anything like that. The thing in the middle, if you see this kind of stone thing, which is very nicely, it's got some pietra dura and stuff like that. This was a carpet weight, a simple carpet weight that you would put on the corner of the carpets to make sure that they didn't fly off. But even there, they had to have like everything just right. That's another emerald box. That's a rock crystal flask was what they used to store perfumes in. And then this is a rose water. And similar to what Archana said in about the Vijayanagar kingdom, the Zenana was another level, you know? It was another world altogether where it was guarded by eunuchs. No man could enter on pain of death. So you would see a scene, something like this, where, I don't know, because of the lights, you can see properly. It's another king, but you'd see one king, maybe some younger male children, and hundreds of women around. And inside the Zenana, they would be free to walk around as they wanted. But nobody actually ever saw them, any of the Mughal princesses or queens. So whenever you see, okay, this is a painting of Noor Jahan, this is a painting of Mumtaz Mahal, we don't know. The artist imagined a face that he could see in the market because there was just no question that their faces would be seen, much less painted by somebody outside the... We don't know. Even Mumtaz well. People have imagination. So you say, oh, is that Noor Jahan? But the artist would not have been allowed to go in. So he would have maybe seen another beauty and kind of transposed her as a model. Now, the Zenana used to have... So what do we see about the clothes here? They are also transparent. And they were quite transparent. Actually, there's a very funny story where... the muslin, as I said, was so thin that once Aurangzeb's daughter, Zeb-un-Nissa, came out, and her Aurangzeb was quite conservative, as we know. So he kind of had a fit and he said, okay, you need to go and, you know, kind of change your clothes. So she said, I'm already wearing 7 layers of kurta. But even after 7 layers, it was still transparent, and her father was still kind of like shocked by the way she came out. And you see that some of them would dress as guys, some of them would dress more in a feminine way. They would, even if they had entertainers, it would either be boys who had not yet reached puberty or women. And there would be plenty of intrigue and, you know, like life was not stayed. There was a lot going on. This is interesting because they show us firecrackers. They show a phuljari. So they would do that on festivals. They would play chopard and chess. So all the Mughals were totally crazy about chess and chopard. And they would make very high bets. And they were in Jahangir's court, the Persian ambassador apparently lost a chess match. And as part of the bet, he had to bray like a donkey in the open court. So it was not, things were not as dignified as they are made to seem in the history books. Now, just imagine that you kind of also tired tracking around Akbar, who needed only 3 hours of sleep a night, by the way, and all of his courtiers had to be up with him at the same time. But you think, okay, now he's going to rest in the zinana, but you see that he's suddenly wearing very coarse clothes and he's kind of left behind his guard and he slipped out with just a couple of people. Akbar used to go out into town quite often. He used to really enjoy that. He wanted to get the pulse of the nation and, you know what's going on. And obviously, he wanted to be praised. So he would always get into things and start asking people, what do you think, you know? And more often than not, they would start with, things don't change, you know, in India. So they would start criticizing. They're saying, government doesn't know what it's doing. You know, onions prices are going up. Dal is so expensive. This, that. Courtiers are totally out of touch. So once he started asking a lot of questions, and then this person got very suspicious. So he's like, wait, who are you? You don't look like a local. Why are you asking so many questions? Then another guy said, you know something? You resemble the emperor. Then he got really scared because he's in a very, very vulnerable position. And anybody can kidnap him or anything can happen. So he's written, this is, he recounted in the court the next day. He said, then I made my idiot face. And they said, these are not the noble features of a king. So they said, no, you cannot be the emperor. And that's how I managed to get away. Now, Akbar's still not done, yeah? Because suddenly it becomes sundown. And almost immediately, almost simultaneously, thousands of diyas go up, lighting up the whole fort. So just imagine the hundreds of people who were there, ready to do it at the same time. One of his favorite activities, like I said, he was dyslexic. But he, I think, had a personal library of 24,000 books. And he would love to be read to day and night. But in our imagined day, he's being read a book which he has actually recommended to one of his sons, saying this is a really great book in life, about life. It's in Persian, but it's the Mahabharata. Because he has the Ramayana and the Mahabharata and many other texts also translated into Persian. And fun fact, all of the Mughal miniatures, which we always, at least I don't know about you guys, but I used to wonder, why don't they just make them bigger, right? Because each part is amazing if you magnify it, but because they were all supposed to be part of books earlier. So it was always for illustrated manuscripts. Now that they have been taken apart and done, but the point was not to have a wall painting, but to have an exquisitely painted book at the end of it. Now, finally, he must be done, but he's not actually, because he was also obsessed. He had many obsessions, Akbar did. He used to love polo, okay? But in the night, you cannot play polo. So he invented a new type of polo ball, which was carved outside with a little space for fire inside, which was basically the original glow-in-the-dark ball. You can actually see one from his time in the City Palace in Jaipur. They unfortunately didn't really let me take a photo of it, but it shows you how it would work. And all of his courtiers had to be extremely enthusiastic about it. They couldn't just be lackluster saying we're tired. Because if you didn't show enough skill and enthusiasm, you were at a very real risk of being exiled to one of the far outposts of the empire, like Assam or Afghanistan, which would do your career prospects and your life expectancy no good. So basically, this is it. Akbar lived a very long life, and Jahangir came after him. The Mughals went from strength to strength until Aurangzeb's time, militarily as well, and but culturally for even much longer. And they've left enduring legacies that we still see in our day-to-day life today. And if nothing else, personally, I'm a bit of a Republican, so I feel that the money could have gone better for education and things like that. But they showed us that how perfect things can get if you have enough time, money, and patience and skill. So that's it. Hope you guys enjoyed. You guys have any? We probably have time for a couple of questions if you guys want. Yeah. Yeah.
About the Mughal, when you saw the evening reading book, why was the letter so small and it was just like this? The pictures and did all letters like this, very slow, very small.
Okay, so it's a bit like a comic book, isn't it? Whatever you are reading, you want to see the picture along with it. So that's the way they used to. And these pictures, as we said, you know, the miniatures we've been showing you, they're all actually from the books. These pictures which we've been showing you of different types, they're all actually from these illustrated manuscripts. The Mughals used to hand paint and hand write each of these books. By then printing had started. So somebody gave Akbar a printed book once. And surprisingly, because he was very far thinking, but when he looked at it, he said, this is so ugly and plain, you know, why would anybody want to own a book like this? So each of those 24,000 books, you know, why? So each of those 24,000 books he owned were like that. They were like those very special, beautiful books. They were not plain ones. And Mughals liked everything very beautiful. So when the British came and the foreigners came and they would give gifts to him. So for example, when they gave him a telescope, he was very fascinated. He loved the whole concept. Then he got one made for himself with gold and gemstones, right? He's not going to use some plain telescope. They presented him with an English carriage, which had a very interesting design. Then again with the carriage, he got it made in gold. And with, you know, so this is, and somebody came and gave him a painting of the oil painting in that style. So he told his painters, Jahangir was very proud of his knowledge of painting. And he said, I can look at a painting and tell which artist has painted the eye and which artist has painted the hand. So he got those paintings replicated so that you couldn't make out the difference between, say, the British Renaissance, you know, that level of painting and his. So, okay. Yeah?
What were the five ministers of Akbar called?
Okay. So, he had lots of ministers, but we say that there are these nine Navratan, you know, nine main ministers. We showed the pictures to you of six of them just now. So I don't know if you want to talk about Birbal, Todarmal, Abul Fazl, Rahim, Badayuni.
I'm asking, what were the five intelligent ministers of Akbar called?
The nine intelligent were called Navratan. I have not heard of any term for five, but we can call them Panchratna if you like. Panch is five, right? Okay. Good. Okay. Any more questions? Yeah. Okay. That's the last, yeah? Yeah.
And when were the epics translated into Persian?
So, he got them translated in, I mean, 1570s, 1580s, like that. I don't know if anybody else had got them translated. Akbar did. And it's a bit funny because he got this gentleman called Badayuni to translate them for him. And Badayuni, while he, because Akbar's court was very liberal, he used to maintain a very liberal thing. But actually, he was quite observant, strict Muslim. So he didn't like the job he was asked to do, but then he did it. And later he wrote about it after Akbar died, about how, you know, he had been put in that position. But he was a very good writer. So they were, Faizi and Badayuni were the people who translated them. Yeah. Okay, last one, absolutely.
So
thought was about Vijayanagar. Hmm. In the court, why did they speak Telugu, not Kannada?
Well, so these people, the Vijayanagar founders, Huck and Book, or Harihar and Devaraya, they were feudatories of Warangal. So Warangal was a kingdom which is based in just north of Hyderabad. The city of Warangal is there. Again, it has beautiful ruins. If you ever get a chance, you should see it. So they used to be actually noblemen who were feudatories of Warangal. And later they came towards this side and founded the kingdom. So their native language was actually Telugu. So while the people of Karnataka already spoke Kannada, and Kannada was an important literary language of the, you know, before that you had the Chalukyas. You had the Hoysal and the Chalukya rulers before that. They used to use Kannada. But because Huck and Book were Telugu, so Telugu actually became the most important language in those days. And a lot of the literature was written in Telugu. But a lot of the high literature and all was written in Sanskrit. Okay. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, ma'am.